Hello and welcome back to Seeker Plus, where we take deep dives on one topic. I'm your host, Julian Huguet, and the topic of this series is near and dear to my heart. We're going to talk about SSTs, supersonic transports, aka commercial jets that fly faster than the speed of sound. We're going to go into the physics of sound, how it relates to aircraft, and then we'll talk about the SSTs of the past. And lastly, we'll look to the future and examine how they could finally make a comeback. But first, I want to go back a bit. Do you remember your childhood obsession? Was it comic books, dinosaurs, space? Knowing our audience, I'd bet it was something fantastically nerdy. Well, for me, it was airplanes. I had piles of books on fighter jets, a collection of glue and fingerprint-covered models. I knew I was never destined to be a fighter pilot. I was gifted with the athletic prowess of a tangled marionette and the eyesight of an old dog, but I settled for a more attainable dream instead. I wanted to fly faster than the speed of sound. Now, when I was growing up, that was actually a possibility, but today, it isn't. You know, unless I make friends with someone who has a spare F-16 in a back seat that they can loan me. Commercial airplanes now are no faster than they were in the 1960s. Why is that? I mean, surely we've made advances in engines and materials and computers. Why can't we just strap some fancy, ultra-powerful engines to a jetliner and go from New York to LA in half the time it takes now? Well, there are a lot of reasons, but pretty much all of them are rooted in the physics of sound. Now, to understand why the speed of sound is so important for aircraft, first, we have to have a solid understanding of what sound is. Sound is a wave that carries energy, but when I say wave, you might picture something like ripples on a pond that move the surface up and down as they propagate outward. That's a transverse wave, and sound doesn't move that way. Sound is what's called a longitudinal wave, and it oscillates in the same direction it propagates. Sounds fancy, but try and break it down with an example. Picture a stretched out slinky. Now, if you were to take one end and give it a quick push, you would see the coils of the slinky come together in an area of compression. Now, that bunched up section of slinky travels down the coils, carrying the energy from that initial push along to the other end. The coils themselves, they don't move very much. They just bunch up when the wave comes along and stretch out after, what's known as rarefaction. And then they pretty much return to where they started. Sound works in a similar way. When something makes a sound, it does so by pushing on the air molecules, which bump into their neighbors and create an area where the air is at a higher pressure than the air next to it. The air molecules pass the energy along, bumping into their neighbors like a clumsy conga line until the wave reaches your ears and your brain interprets the pressure changes. Also, I could play with this thing all day. Somebody take it away from me. Okay. Sound is also a mechanical wave, meaning it needs a medium to travel through. That can be a liquid or solid or a gas like air. Unlike light, it can't travel through a vacuum. That's why they say in space, no one can hear you scream. Ah! It's also why sci-fi movies that have explosions in space drive me up the wall, but I do guess it would be anticlimactic if the rebels blew up the Death Star and all the theater heard was... Anyway, sound travels at different speeds depending on the medium, moving the slowest through gas and the fastest through a solid. Its speed also changes depending on the temperature of the medium. Temperature is, after all, how fast molecules are vibrating. So at higher temperatures, they'll bounce off each other more quickly, and sound will travel faster. What this means is, down at sea level, where air is warmer, the speed of sound is about 340 meters per second, or 760 miles per hour, if you can only think in freedom units like me. At the altitudes airliners typically fly, the air is much colder, around negative 56 degrees Celsius, and the speed of sound up there is much slower as a result. It moves at about 295 meters per second, or 660 miles per hour. That's almost 50 meters per second slower than down here by the nice warm ground. So, next time someone's trying to get your attention and you want to ignore them, maybe just say it was too cold, the sound took too long to reach you. And then when they give you a bewildered stare, you can refer them to this show and we'll grow our audience, you'll stay introverted, everybody wins. Okay, back to the speed of sound. Because it's different at different altitudes, it's easier to think of it using Mach numbers. not mock numbers like pi, you're so irrational or whatever. No matter the air temperature, the speed of sound can simply be referred to as Mach 1, M-A-C-H. It's named after Ernst Mach, an Austrian physicist who, among his many, many contributions to science and philosophy, did pioneering work in the late 1800s investigating how supersonic projectiles affect the air they move through. He did this by taking pictures of bullets in flight and even borrowed a cannon from the Austrian Navy for his work, which sounds like a sweet perk of the job. So let's come back to the key question, which is, why does all of this matter for airplanes? Well, sound, as we established, travels as air molecules bump into each other and it moves at a finite speed. Airplanes travel, wait for it, through the air. So if an airplane is flying well below the speed of sound, the air ahead of it can move out of the way and everything goes smoothly. But as its speed approaches Mach 1, things start to act very differently. Even though the airplane itself may not be going the speed of sound, some air passing over some parts of it, like the top of the wing, can go supersonic. And when that happens, the air molecules get squeezed together faster than they can get out of the way, and they create a shock wave. These shock waves move back as the plane speeds up, and they can cause the nose of the airplane to pitch downward and make controls unresponsive, sending an airplane into a dive from which there is no escape. Many brave test pilots died pushing their planes past the limit. It was such a massive challenge, it was dubbed the sound barrier. The worst instability comes when an airplane is in what's known as the transonic range, which is from about Mach 0.8 to Mach 1.2. Past that, and the air moving over the wings is all supersonic, making it smooth and stable again. But for a commercial airplane, another problem arises above Mach 1, the sonic boom. An airplane traveling faster than the speed of sound literally outruns the sound it makes. It'll pass by you before you even hear it. For the poor air molecules in its path, this means they get no warning that a plane is coming and they get absolutely blindsided. They're plowed into a cone-shaped shockwave just ahead of the plane's nose where air pressure instantly spikes. Couple this with the shockwave that started on the wing and has since moved back to the plane's trailing edge, and the result is a loud double boom that can break glass. And contrary to popular belief, a sonic boom doesn't just happen at the moment a plane breaks the sound barrier, it's generated continuously. Heavier planes tend to make bigger booms, so to anyone below the flight path of a supersonic passenger jet, they could be a nuisance at best and possibly dangerous at worst. In fact, public outrage over sonic booms is a big part of what nearly doomed SSTs before they even got off the ground the first time around. We'll get into that in our next episode. For now, though, I hope it's clear why the speed of sound is so important to how aircraft are designed and why today's jetliners have a speed limit below Mach 1, much like they did 60 years ago. On the next episode of Seeker Plus, we'll talk about a time between then and now when supersonic flight was available to anyone for a price and why that boom time was unsustainable. Until then, I hope you enjoyed this episode. Let me know if you're digging the aviation stuff because I could talk about it forever. And likewise, if I've reawakened a childhood obsession of yours and you want us to talk about it, let us know in the comments. Thanks for watching.